Namaste to all of you. My name is Dr. Hemant Bhargav. I am assistant professor in the Department of Integrative Medicine at NIMHANS. My presentation is based on the biological markers of the effects of yoga on various brain functions. I have categorized my presentation into these three domains: the neuroimaging findings, neurochemical findings, and neurophysiological findings associated with yoga. The predominant work that has been done by us at NIMHANS, which I am going to present here. So it is very important to understand the way in which yoga works on the brain. First, I'll give you a brief understanding of some areas of the brain and their functions before we understand the effects of yoga. So this particular area of the brain, which is known as the PFC and ACC, the anterior cingulate cortex and the prefrontal cortex, these are the areas of the brain which are also called as the neocortex. This is the area which human beings have gained through the process of evolution, which is unique to them and biggest in human beings. This particular area is predominantly responsible for planning and discriminative functions. It gives you an ability to control your impulsiveness and then decide properly what is to be done and what is not to be done in a particular situation. Therefore, the majority of impulses which this area sends are inhibitory in nature, and these inhibitory signals are sent to the lower areas of the brain. Now here you can see in the red, the lower areas of the brain, the amygdala and the hippocampus, the limbic cortex. This particular area is common in animals also. Here we see that this is the area which is responsible for emotional processing. If the area is overactivated, it means that you have rage, anger, negative memories, compulsion and craving. So what we have observed through yoga research is that yoga practices have the ability to calm down the lower brain areas, whereas there are selective practices which can activate the higher brain areas. This is a research that we did at NIMHANS. We assessed the effect of chanting the Vedic sound Om on the activation patterns in the brain. 12 healthy subjects went into a MRI scanner. They were in a lying down position and they chanted the sound Om in the ratio 1:2. The same subject as a control repeated the sound to match the breathing rate, and they performed 10 sets of this practice, 10 rounds in each cycle. Randomly, they performed both the interventions, and then when we assessed their brain images, we found that during the chant of the Om, there was deactivation of the limbic area, which is the area that I told you is associated with negative memories. In fact, this area is known to become hyperactive in patients who suffer from depression. There is a technique to treat depression where the ear, the auricular branch of the vagus nerve is electrically stimulated with the hypothesis that it will deactivate the limbic cortex as a treatment for depression. And here we hypothesize that it is probably the humming part of the Om, the part of the Om, which has generated the vibration in the ear canal and stimulated the auricular branch of the vagus nerve, which thereby would have led to deactivation of the limbic cortex. This is an image that I have got from a publication that was there in Financial Times, where investigators came here from UK and they wanted to understand what we are doing in terms of the research in the field of yoga. Here, this device that you can see is known as the FNIRS device, functional near infrared spectroscopy. So this is a device also does similar functions which a MRI scanner does, but it can only do it on the superficial layers of the brain, especially the prefrontal cortex area. The higher brain function area can be assessed using this device. So we did the same study that we did in a scanner with this device, with another breathing technique, which is known as the Kapalabhati Pranayama. Kapalabhati, as you know, involves flapping movement of the abdomen. But we were wondering why Sage gave it a name as Kapala. Kapala means forehead and Bhati means shining. So because it just involves the abdominal flapping, what was it that made Sages choose a name as Kapalabhati for the technique? Therefore, we assessed the prefrontal activation during the Kapalabhati breathing. The subject performs 120 strokes of Kapalabhati. We took a baseline of 5 minutes, then they perform Kapalabhati for 1 minute, 120 strokes per minute, that is 2 strokes per second. And then again, a baseline for 5 minutes. And what we observed was that the OxyHb level, the OxyHb is oxyhemoglobin, which is a marker of activation of a particular brain area. It significantly increased during the practice and then came down. So therefore, we can say that there is a technique in yoga where you can enhance your willpower, your ability to plan and ability to control your impulsiveness by doing Kapalabhati. And at the same time, you can calm down the lower brain areas and you can process your emotions better by performing Om chanting. This is another study that we did on a small sample of elderly subjects here at Nimhans. In this study, the elderly subjects performed a validated yoga program for the elderly. The program was performed for 1 hour per day, 5 days a week for 6 months. It is usually a natural process of aging that the brain shrinks, especially the hippocampus is one area of the brain which is known to shrink with aging, and it shrinks even more if a person suffers from dementias such as Alzheimer's. Here, we could demonstrate that not only did the natural shrinking process of the hippocampus stop in these elderlies, but there was a marginal increase in the size of the hippocampus after performing 6 months of regular yoga, even in an elderly population. We have also performed certain studies to assess the effect of yoga on various neurochemicals. One of them, a very important one, is the cortisol. It is known that yoga reduces cortisol, but we wanted to see it in depressed subjects. Yoga now can also be used as a monotherapy for mild to moderate depression without any antidepressant medication. There are such recommendations coming through recent papers. In this study, we divided subjects suffering from major depressive disorder into 3 arms, yoga, yoga plus medicine, and medicine. And then when they performed, they underwent a yoga intervention of 12 weeks, 5 days a week. We have validated yoga modules for these disorders. What we observed was that all the 3 groups showed a reduction in their depression scores on the scales, but it was the yoga plus meditation and yoga group that showed a significant reduction in cortisol, but not the medication only group. What does it mean? It means that though medications are also able to alter the brain chemicals and improve your mood, but they are not able to remove the underlying stress. But if you add yoga along with medications, that not only is that your depressive symptoms come down, but underlying stress is also removed. Probably that is the reason that those who take antidepressant medicines for a long time but do not do yoga, and when they stop the medicines, there is an increased chance for them to relapse. But if you make yoga a part of your lifestyle, then probably the regular yoga practice may prevent that relapse. BDNF is another chemical known as brain-derived neurotrophic factor. Now, this is a chemical which is responsible for neuroplasticity, the ability of the brain to regenerate and form new synaptic connections. It also is related to your cognitive functions. It is known that BDNF levels reduce when a person suffers from serious mental illness such as depression. And here in this study, again, we were able to demonstrate that after 12 weeks of regular yoga practice, there was an increase in the level of the neurotrophic factor BDNF. So there is a biological basis through which we can say that yoga enhances your synaptic connections in the brain and makes it adapt better to any kind of insult. So this is how we demonstrated that there was a increase in BDNF and reduction in the cortisol levels as compared to the controls in the yoga group. And there was a relationship between cortisol and BDNF in that study. Similarly, another study we have done on schizophrenia patients. It is known that schizophrenia patients, schiz means split and phrenia means personality. These people get split and disconnected with the society. They remain socially withdrawn. They become paranoid about society. And these patients, initially they have a lot of positive symptoms in terms of hallucinations, delusions. But with medications, those positive symptoms reduce. But the negative symptoms of schizophrenia, which are lack of interest, amotivation, reduced socialization, inability to hold on to a occupation, they do not improve with medicine. So we performed a research on these schizophrenia subjects, and we found that a regular practice of around 8 weeks of yoga intervention was able to enhance the ability of these schizophrenia patients to socialize better. It was able to make them adhere to a job better. It reduced their amotivation and enhanced their interest in the activities. They started merging and mingling with the society better. When we observed these effects, we were wondering what may be the mechanism through which these effects would have been produced. So therefore, we measured a particular neurotransmitter known as oxytocin. Oxytocin is also known as hormone, the loving hormone, the connecting hormone. It is also the hormone which enhances the bonding between mother and child. So we measured this particular hormone after 4 weeks of yoga intervention, and we observed that there was a significant increase in oxytocin levels in schizophrenia patients who performed yoga than those who only took medications. This is a very popular research in the field of yoga, where Streeter et al. From USA were able to demonstrate that a single session of yoga enhanced GABA levels. Gamma aminobutyric acid is another neurotransmitter which, if it is more, it generates a feeling of calmness and reduces the anxiety. But if it comes down, then the person has a higher tendency to become agitated and anxious. So this Streeter et al. Demonstrated this, that in the particular area of the brain known as thalamus, that there was an increase in the level of GABA. We use another technique, which is an indirect technique to measure GABA. It is known as transmagnetic stimulation technique. So when you stimulate the premotor area of the brain, it leads to a twitch in a muscle in your hand. And between this process, there is a period where there is no impulse. This is known as cortical silent period. This period is an indirect marker of GABA-B transmission. And the higher the cortical period, the more is the recruitment of the GABAergic neurons. So here we were able to see that after the yoga practice, the cortical silent period increased. It means that the GABA functions were increased after yoga intervention. So we also did a cross-sectional study where we showed that experienced yoga practitioners had higher cortical silent period than the non-practitioners. And in this study, you can see that depressed subject had a lower cortical period. After walking, it increased, but not to a significant extent. And then in the same subjects, pre-yoga, this was the level, but post-yoga, the increase in the cortical silent period was much higher than walking. And then these are the levels of healthy individuals. So you can see here that healthy individuals have a high cortical silent period, means a enhanced GABA function. And then depressed subjects have low GABA function, but as they do yoga, they start moving closer towards the healthy population. We also observed that there was a positive correlation between the number of yoga sessions and the duration of the cortical silent period. It means that it was a dose dependent kind of pattern. The more yoga sessions people perform, the higher were the tendency to report their increase in CSP. It means that the more you perform yoga, the more you can enhance GABA in the brain. There is another way in which you can assess these functions. This is known as the mirror neuron activity. Now, mirror neurons are special neurons located in the premotor area. Now, these are the neurons which get activated when you imitate certain things, when you see certain activities which are happening and your brain wants to imitate it. This also means that you feel connected to the person if there is more mirror neuron activation in the brain. Here in healthy volunteers, we were able to demonstrate that mirror neuron activation through TMS was increased after 1 month of yoga practice. Similarly, using the FNIRS device, we were able to show that actually there was an increased activation in the premotor area after performing yoga intervention in 36 healthy individuals, when they were seeing a task where some action was done as compared to a static task. So when you see activity and you see that there is an increased activation in a particular area of the brain after yoga, it means that you were able to connect with that activity and with that person better after yoga. So this carries an implication that yoga may be helpful in enhancing social connect. Now in this COVID-19 times, everybody is talking about social distancing. And in various psychiatric disorders, social distancing, social withdrawal is actually a major risk factor. We see recent incidences where due to psychiatric illnesses, film star suicide, he felt disconnected with everyone. And that is why he developed this impulse to end his life. Now here I am showing you some evidence that yoga is something which can connect. So though physically we need social distancing, mentally, emotionally, we need a connect even more in these difficult times. And yoga can be a very wonderful tool to enhance this social connect. In fact, the very word of the yoga comes from the Sanskrit root yuj, which means to unite. And it is no wonder that yoga has become a global tool now to unite humanity, and we need much more of this particular wonderful science than before. So this is the summary of my presentation. We can say that yoga enhances GABA, it makes you calm and relaxed, it enhances mirror neuron activity and thereby enhances your connectivity, it reduces the stress hormone cortisol, enhances the neuroplasticity by increasing brain-derived neurotrophic factor, increases the loving kindness hormone oxytocin, increases compassion and bonding between human beings by increasing oxytocin, and it deactivates the brain areas which increase agitation and generate negative memories. I would like to acknowledge our director, Dr. B.N. Gangadhar, who is the force behind all this research that we have done at NIMHANS. I am also very grateful to my mentor, Dr. Sivarama Varampalli, who is our head of department and who is our guiding force now for the future directions of our researches. All these researches have been done by the Department of Psychiatry at NIMHANS, and I am really grateful to all the faculties from Department of Psychiatry at NIMHANS. Dr. R. Nagaratna and Dr. H. R. Nagendra from SVSI University are my teachers who have taught me yoga. I am really grateful to them. This is our team at NIMHANS, which has worked in doing these researches and is exploring this area further. I am really thankful to all of you for your patient listening. Kindly send your feedback to yogaforstress.nimhans@gmail.com. Thank you very much.